The record reflect, it is now 5 p.m. If everyone would take their seats, please. If I could have everyone take your seat, please. If I could have everyone take your seat, please. We have a full agenda ahead of us tonight, and we would like to get started. We may have some folks joining as the minutes progress, but I'm sure that once our children are in front of us, they'll do so quietly and expeditiously. But welcome to all of you. Thank you for being here tonight. We have so much on our agenda tonight to cover, and we are delighted to have students back in the boardroom with us tonight and look forward to recognizing you for all of your accomplishments. A lot of folks in the boardroom, welcome to each of you. We're glad you're here. And at this point, if you would all stand with me, please, and join in the Pledge of Allegiance. And the Kids at Hope pledge, as an adult and a treasure hunter, I am committed to search for all the talents, skills, and intelligence that exist in all children and youth. I believe all children are capable of success, no exceptions. Thank you. One detail of housekeeping, if you would like to be an unscheduled speaker at the meeting tonight, there are forms available at the back of the room that you just need to fill out and bring to Mrs. Harrison, and she will keep them in order and pass them along to me when the time is correct. If you would just please get them to her before the start of the business portion of our meeting. And due to time constraints, we have advertised the public hearing to begin at 5:15. And since it is not that time, we are going to do a little flip-flop with our agenda this evening and move to the special orders of business first. So, Madam Superintendent?
Yes, ma'am. It is a pleasure to have so many students with us this evening who have earned recognition at the conclusion of last year as well as throughout the summer. And we'd like to invite Nick Zralik, Director of Curriculum, to come forward, please. And we'll begin with the Zero Robotics recognition, student recognition. Mr. Zralik.
Thank you, Superintendent. As we go through, we do have three special orders of business. The first one is Zero Robotics. For the second year in a row, Southern Oaks Middle School hosted the Zero Robotics Middle School Summer Program, a five-week STEM program designed to engage students in learning and working in a 3D environment. Applying forces and Newton's laws, using conditionals for programming robotic spheres, which are synchronized, position, hold, engage, reorient, experimental satellites. This year's team placed third in the regional competition. Our program facilitator, Kevin McInerney, an instructor at Southern Oaks, supported students with hands-on experiences in programming their satellites to compete with other teams in Florida. Students learned to navigate obstacles and strategize for fuel conservation, as well as develop an appreciation for science, technology, engineering, and math, that is STEM. Teams competed by programming their strategies into these spheres and then proceeded to the elimination rounds, whereby each satellite's speed, rotation, and direction of travel were factors in determining the winner of each round. We do have a list of the team members up on the screen. I will call those names, and if we could, as we have those names mentioned, have those people come forward to be recognized and receive an award, and also to be in a photograph. So we have Logan Baker, Ann Jaeger, Gioia Periello, Grizel Cabrera, Andrew Johnson, Jacob Powers, Elijah Canangalo, Michael LaFrance, LaFrancois, April Vasquez, Michael Futo, and Hensley Ledger. We also have We also had a high school volunteer that assisted with the program, Jager Johnson, and then our sponsor, I would ask him if he is still here to go ahead and come forward as well, which is Kevin McInerney.
And to continue with our second area would be NEED, National Energy Education Development. Student recognition once again.
Our next award is connected with the NEED project, as Superintendent just shared. NEED does stand for the National Energy Education Development. The mission of NEED is to promote an energy-conscious and educated society by creating effective networks of students, educators, business, government, and community leaders to design and deliver objective, multi-sided energy education programs. In this program, students at all grade levels learn about the forms of energy, heat, light, motion, sound, nuclear energy, and electrical engineering, with age-appropriate hands-on explorations that emphasize the scientific process and an application of the newly gained energy knowledge to understanding energy sources, electricity generation, and much, much more. Let's meet the teams that we had going and the recognitions that they've received. We had a team from Mariposa. Now, most of these students, because it was last school year, aren't at Mariposa, which is a great sign. We wouldn't want them to be there anymore. So we do have the schools that they're currently at. So as we go through, again, we'll call them forward. If they could come forward, again, Mr. Reef will be handing out the award, and then if they could stay for a photo. We have Jan Feliciano Alvarez, Monica Colina, Alicia Lillard, Justin Locklar, Michaela Sampson, Joanne Viana, Ariana White, Hannah Wright, and Tanazia Young. And then we have the project advisors of Adam Archer and Mary McCartney. So if they're here, if they could come forward as well. Ha ha ha.
your children participated in the NEED project by traveling to Washington, D.C. from Mariposa, now at middle school. Please stand.
We had another team that came from Morningside Elementary last year, and again, they have this year's schools up there. So again, if this team can come forward, we've got Isabella Cruz, Paul Mukhamedov, Zoya Mukhamedov, Grace Robinson, Emmanuel Ruda, and then the project advisor, Molly Mukhamedov. And then we have our third team, which came from Lincoln Park Academy, which had the Florida Junior Rookie of the Year. We have Cody Jennings and Alex Orovec, and then the project advisor is Marlu Jennings.
Moving on to Odyssey of the Mind. So this is our third area of recognition this evening. Mr. Zralik?
Odyssey of the Mind is a creative problem-solving competition for students of all ages. Teams of students select a problem, create a solution, then present their solution in a competition against other teams in the same problem and division. The teams of up to seven students work under the guidance of an adult coach. We've got a short video that just highlights some of the things from last year's competitions.
I used to bite my tongue and hold my breath, scared to rock the boat and make a mess. So I said quietly, agreed politely. I guess that I forgot I had a choice. I let you push me past the breaking point. I stood for nothing, so I fell for everything. You held me down, but I got up, already brushing off the dust. You hear my voice, you hear that sound, like thunder gonna shake the ground. You held me down, but I got up, get ready cause I've had enough.
Dancing through the fire, cause I am a champion, and
again call forward the teams, and if they could come forward to receive an award and then stay for a picture. So for Morningside Elementary, they were second in the world for Problem 2 Division 1. We have Eliza Ahmed, Erica Austria, Kendrick Carpenter, Nachapa Dan Carngent, Noah Hamilton, Angela Schaefer, Charles Willoughby. We had a parent coach, Michelle Lucky, a spontaneous coach, Amy Spur, and a coordinator, Catherine Oliver. Jane Hartman. Okay. And Jane Hartman was the coach, I was just told. I apologize. Our next team was from Lincoln Park Academy. They were eighth in the world for Problem 2 Division 3. We have Bailey Canis, William Clarizio, Rachel Howard, Hamza Razuman, Samreen Razuman, Brendan Rouse, Samantha Strong, and their coordinator was Judy Huter. And our final team comes from Fort Pierce Central. They were 12th in the world for Problem 2 Division 3. We have Vincent Altvader, Kendall Spur, Mavie Tucker, Quinn Tucker, Viviana Valentin, and then the coordinator, Cindy Schwertfeger. And the coach for that team is Diane Tucker.
would proudly like to rise.
No doubt St. Lucie County is in good hands. Well done to all of you. Congratulations again. And especially to all of the adult mentors out there, the teachers, the coaches, everyone that has made this possible for these students to go and achieve such high, high accolades. So we're grateful that you all are here. And yes, it is okay to escape. I know you have things to do, homework, all of those things to do. So thank you for being here with us tonight. Give them just a second to exit the auditorium, and then we will move to the public hearing portion of our meeting. Okay, I think most everyone has made their way out. There's just a lot of hugs and smiles and congratulations going on, which is a wonderful thing for our students. At this time, we will open the public hearing and invite anyone that would care to speak to the issue tonight, which is the adoption of the budget. Any among the audience that care to speak to this issue? Okay. Seeing none come forward, Madam Superintendent, we will receive your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. There are five separate recommendations. I recommend the board approve the final required local effort millage of 4.9930 mills as specified in the resolution 2014-15 trim final A.
Board members, we've received the recommendation. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second. Moved by Dr. Mills, second by Ms. Hilson. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
I recommend the board approve the district school tax discretionary operating millage of 0.7480 mills as specified in the resolution 2014-15 trim final A.
Board members, we have the recommendation. Do I hear a motion?
Second.
Moved by Ms. Hensley, second by Dr. Mills. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Wait a minute.
I recommend the board approve the district discretionary local capital improvement millage of 1.5 mills as specified in the resolution 2014-15 trim final A.
Board members, you have the recommendation. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Ms. Hilson, second by Mr. Ingersoll. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion also carries 5-0.
I recommend the board adopt the 2014-15 final budget in the amount of $447,784,219.71.
Board members, we've received the recommendation. Do I hear a motion?
Second.
Moved by Ms. Hensley, second by Dr. Mills. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
I recommend the board adopt Resolution Trim 2014-15 Final B, authorizing flexibility with categorical funds. Resolution Trim 2014-15 Final C, certifying adoption of the final millage rates by separate vote. And Resolution Trim 2014-15 Final D, certifying adoption of the final budget.
Board members, we have the recommendation. Do I hear a motion?
Second.
Moved by Ms. Hilson, second by Mr. Ingersoll. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Thank you. Thank you for being available, Mr. Bergeron, in case there were any questions. And we will now close the public hearing and resume the regular meeting of the school board. Madam Superintendent?
Yes, ma'am. If we move to special thanks and recognition star presentation, I'd like to ask Ms. Durger to come forward, please, at this time. I know that our employee to be recognized is not here this evening.
Correct. Good evening. The employee that was going to be recognized this evening had an emergency, and so we chose to put it off to the next board meeting. We'll be recognizing two individuals. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Madam Chair, while we are under special orders of business, do you want to consider moving the presentation from our youth, regarding our youth initiative, forward at this time, or to retain it in its current location?
Well, it erroneously was put there, so we do need to move ahead. I know Mr. Baldwin has other things to get to tonight, saving our city, so we'll move to that at this point.
This time we welcome Chief Baldwin from Fort Pierce Police Department, and he is addressing Restoring the Village Youth Initiative. He has a presentation to share with us and with our viewers this evening to educate us on some developments within the city. Welcome, Chief Baldwin.
Superintendent Yost, members of the board, thank you very much. If I could just take just a second to point out a few of the members of the team, this certainly isn't, I didn't do any of this alone. Superintendent Yost is one of the members of our team. We also have Danny Dreisenter, who is an officer that works for the Fort Pierce Police Department. She's our juvenile specialist, and she's actually, you'll see later on, she's acting as our interim project coordinator here. Shanique Maynard, who is now the executive director with the Roundtable of St. Lucie County. If any of you didn't know that, I'm sure that word is that. And we have Clint Sperber, who's the deputy director of the health department in St. Lucie County. And Sean Boyle from the Children's Services Council. So they're all here with me. They elected me as the spokesperson. So if you'll bear with me for a few minutes, I'll go through this. We've had a lot of questions about what's going on to address the violence in the community, and specifically the gangs. And we want to give you an update on that and what's going on. So you will recall almost exactly a year ago, Representative Larry Lee hosted a series or two of community forums to talk about the gang violence in our community and what was going on. And that became known as the Restoring the Village effort or initiative. From the community forums that we had, we actually put together a list of groups or areas or focus areas that we felt needed to be addressed in order to provide a comprehensive response to the gang problems in Fort Pierce. We took that group and we started looking at what other communities had been doing. And we actually had a doctor from Louisville come down, and Louisville had just been through a similar process where they were trying to address some of the youth violence and other initiatives in their neighborhood, and they put together a very comprehensive plan. So we looked at their plan. The next thing that we looked at was what's called the Comprehensive Gang Model, and I'm going to introduce that to you here in just a few minutes. But it's actually an effort from the Office of Juvenile and Justice and Delinquency Prevention. The most important about this is this comes full circle, and I'll show you on the last slide is on September 30th, we're going to have a follow-up community forum so that we can take this plan back to the community. And we believe that we're going to deliver what the, exactly what the community has asked us to do in terms of a comprehensive measure for the violence in our community. So just to sort of introduce, you know, where we're coming from, we had a group of us in March of 2014, Superintendent Yost, Christine Epps, our former executive director for the Roundtable, Shanique Maynard, who was with the U.S. Attorney's Office at the time. We won her over during this trip. And Deputy Administrator Clint Sperber, Chief Probation Officer Wydea Wilson, who's the Chief Juvenile Probation Officer for this area. And again, Superintendent Yost, all went to Dallas for a four-day training on what is called by the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention the Comprehensive Gang Model. And we were there with 10 other communities from around the nation in order to learn about this model. I got to tell you, we were the only community that had a chief of police, a U.S. attorney, a superintendent, a deputy director from the health department, the chief probation officer there. The Office of Juvenile Justice, Delinquency Prevention, and the National Gang Center were impressed with our showing. But that's the way we do things in St. Lucie County, right? We've been practicing through the roundtable for years and years. And when we go in, we go all in and we do it the right way. So let me tell you a little bit about this comprehensive gang model. It's a model that guides communities step by step through the implementation of a comprehensive community-wide strategy. And this has been around in some form or another since about 1985, 1987. And some of you, if you get into the plan, will recognize that it's based on the risk factors and the protective factors, the same science that built the executive roundtables, used to be executive roundtables, hand-in-hand, the comprehensive model that the roundtable has been working on for 15 years. So there's three phases, the assessment and planning phase, capacity building, and the implementation. And again, I want to point out, it's developed by the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, and it's supported by what's called the National Gang Center, which is an entity that is funded by OJGDP, and it actually is in Tallahassee, so that works out to our benefit. We're a little closer than most of the people in the country to that resource. I want to point out that when I say comprehensive gang model, what's important to know up front is this is a comprehensive response to a chronic community problem. We're fooling ourselves if we think this just started happening in the last year or two. This has been going on, well, since I've been a police officer in the 1990s and before the 1990s in Fort Pierce and particularly the Lincoln Park community. So this is not a, we need to respond to the crisis, but this is a strategy, and it's meant to be a long-term strategy. So keep that in mind. The other thing that I want to point out is we're not calling it the comprehensive gang model anymore. We're calling it the Restoring the Village Youth Initiative. It was born from the Restoring the Village effort, and we want it to be known as that. The comprehensive gang model sort of falls flat, to be honest with you, when we're talking about this with the community. So we want to build some momentum around the Restoring the Village name. So some sites that you may, some cities you may recognize, implementation and evaluation sites. The early evaluation starts like sites, like I said, started before the 1990s and went through. Some of the most recent implementations, Denver, Syracuse, Tacoma, just some other sites. There are dozens of other sites that have implemented this in one form or another. The National Gang Center, their executive director, actually told me they were concerned because I asked them to give me a list of sites that had implemented the model. They said, you want all of them that say they've implemented, or you want the ones that have really implemented it? And they gave me the ones that have really implemented or in some stage of really implemented. Because what you're going to see is there's a couple different facets. And what it seems is that some communities are just grabbing one piece of the model and implementing that and not doing it the way it's supposed to be implemented. So they're concerned about that. So just sort of an introduction to the model, the five core components of the model. I want you to recognize that in the middle of all this, and this is extremely important, is the gang-involved youth and their families. Everything that we do has to touch these people personally, individually, and specifically. If it doesn't, it's not going to work, and we have learned that. You know, it's one thing to have a rec center in a neighborhood. It's a whole nother center to have these gang-involved youth and their families using that rec center. So that's what we have to make sure that we're very careful about that. So at the top is community mobilization, which is always extremely important that we have the community support. And there's actually an outcry. We need an outcry from the community to do something about this problem. And I've got to be honest with you. I get a lot of heat for what is going on, but I'm encouraged about just the outright disgust that we have with the violence in the community now. For me, that's a good thing. People, more and more people are stepping up every day and saying, this is not acceptable. This cannot be allowed to go on in our community. And that's what we need to make the change, right? So the next part of this is the social intervention, and I'll talk about that a little bit. The opportunities provision, which is where you come in, education, jobs, recreation for our youth. Suppression is my job, the enforcement, and the organizational change and development to support the model. And those are the policies, budgets, and those kinds of things that we need in order to actually carry this out. So this is from the National Gang Center, and this is their five core components. This is their structure that they want to see communities use. And just not to mince terms, those of you that are familiar with the roundtable, they call this a steering committee. And it's a group of community leaders that get from, you know, different agencies that get together and develop this strategy and implement the strategy. And when we started looking at the list of people that need to be on the committee, the superintendent of schools, the chief of police, the sheriff, judges, all of those people, we said, well, this is a roundtable. We've been doing this for 15 years. So we got together, started thinking about how can we do this. What we actually have done here is we've asked the roundtable to adopt this strategy, and the roundtable has done that. This will be the strategy that the roundtable is using. They have formed a Safe Neighborhoods Network, for those of you who are familiar with the structure of the roundtable, and the primary focus of that network right now is to implement this model. So moving on, how does our structure look so that everybody understands it? And just by way of explaining the model, so we have this Safe Neighborhoods Network, which has a lot of people, I think 15 people participating on this network right now, and they're experts in the various areas of law enforcement, juvenile probation, schools, so forth. We have a lead agency, which right now is the Fort Pierce Police Department. And don't think of the lead agency as somebody that's in charge. The lead agency is organizing the effort, mostly applying for grants and funding and that type of stuff. Then we have a coordinator position, which is extremely important to the position, somebody to carry the flag. And then underneath, you'll see the three, I don't want to call them strategies, but for lack of a better term, the components of the model: prevention, intervention, and suppression. So let me talk about those real quickly. The suppression is easy. It's the things that we have been doing for years and years and years in order to try to address the problems with violence. But in this model, you specifically target those youth gang members that are the most violent in our community, and you target them with enforcement efforts. And we've got to face some facts. There are some violent people in our community that need to go to prison. And that's what this is about. We need to do that, and we need to take them out and make our neighborhoods safe. The intervention efforts are things that we have not done well, at least collectively. We need to bring all this together. The first thing, and one of the most promising components of this, I believe, is the street outreach component. And it's similar to the public health model. Several of you were involved years ago when we learned that St. Lucie County had the worst HIV infection rate among African Americans in the state of Florida. And the roundtable and the health department got together and started working on a plan. And you all were intimately involved, the school board. Some of you were on the board at the time, some of you weren't, but you were intimately involved in one of the strategies that came out of that. Well, another strategy that came out of that was doing outreach into the community. The concept of, obviously, before you can treat the disease and prevent it from being spread, people have to know their status. People would not get tested. They just would not get tested, whether they were afraid or some other reason. So how the health department overcame that is using street outreach and sending outreach workers into the community to build a relationship with the people, convince them to be tested, and then once they were tested, if they were positive, the education, all the services that they needed to provide. And I'm happy to report, Clint always corrects me, I say we're now, it's not the best. We're beating the state averages now in terms of HIV infection. That's an incredible accomplishment from our community. And that is because of this, well, because of what the roundtable and the school board and our community did working together, but outreach was a huge issue. When I talk to people about gang violence, we can't treat it like it's the disease itself. It's a symptom of deeper problems in our community, and we've got to remember that. Just like HIV, it's a symptom of a disease. So we've got to treat this like a disease, and using the public health model gives us the opportunity to do that, and that's part of the comprehensive game model. So what we're going to do is take outreach workers. They're going to build relationships with the specific target population, and I'll show you that population in a few minutes. Their job is to mediate conflict between the gangs and then to steer youth and family towards resources. We found a model called Boston Safe Street Model that is I believe one of the better practices in terms of doing this. And they have both street outreach workers and case managers, so they hold each other accountable. And in Boston, the idea is the street outreach workers go out and build relationship with the youth and their families, and then bring those youth to the case managers so that they can put them on what they call ladders. They have a ladder for education, they have a ladder for job readiness, and they have a ladder for recreation. And they try to get those youth up the ladder, up each of those ladders as high as they can possibly get them. And that's how they judge their success. If the kids fall off the ladder, the outreach workers come back in and pull them back in. And that's the idea. And this is very similar to the model that we use here locally in St. Lucie County for HIV. So the next part of this is the intervention team. And it's a multidisciplinary team. It's staffed by representatives of existing service agencies, and I know that those viewers cannot read all that, but you'll see the school, you'll see job development on there, you'll see youth agencies such as the Boys and Girls Club, or you know, the other agencies that serve youth. Workforce development will be a member of that. Juvenile probation, police officer, the street outreach workers will be a member of this. And really, what it is a everybody's sitting down at a table and taking referrals of young men in our community that are getting involved in gangs and developing a comprehensive case management plan for each individual. And then all of those agencies chipping in to do their part to help, whether it's an issue at school and the school representative actually committing to doing what they need to do, law enforcement committing to do what they need to do, juvenile probation and so forth, and meeting on a weekly basis and talking about that child's issue and trying to lift these children out and away from these gang members. That's something that we can actually do. It doesn't cost money. We've all got the resources, but again, it's going to focus on a specific list of kids that we know are involved in that. So the referrals will come from school, perhaps the teachers or the guidance counselors, principals at the schools, and from law enforcement that actually are probably on the front line of what's going on in these kids' lives. So the last part of this intervention is reentry. We do have young men that have gone away to the detention center, the jail, or even to prison for years and years, that will eventually come back into our community. And that's some of the frustration that we have in law enforcement, is we'll make an arrest, we'll put somebody in jail, and it's always short-lived. Or we'll put somebody in prison, they come back. And without any kind of intervention, they're going to come back into the same circumstances that they're left, and we know that they're going to be violent again. We see it over and over and over again. So part of the intervention effort is to reach out with this intervention to the young men that are in our jails and in our prisons and start trying to provide that intervention before they ever get released. We know who they are, we know when they're gonna get released, and trying to fix the problem so that they don't become violent when they come back to our community. The last component there is the prevention. This is all very simple. It's things that we do every single day in our community. But again, it's about focusing these prevention efforts on this group of kids, the target population that's involved in these gangs. And when I say kids, it's not just kids, and we all know that. It's young adults too. So prevention, or the opportunities, includes education, recreation, and job readiness, and making sure that all of our children have access to those things. Focus on both primary and secondary target populations. I'll talk about that in just a second. And then the biggest part of this is using research-based best practices. It's one thing to throw a program together. It's a whole other thing to do something that's based on research and science and put it together so that we're spending the limited resources that we have in the best way that we can. The great news is that we can leverage the existing programs that we already have in our community. The Boys and Girls Club, the churches, and all the great programs that are already existing in our community. Several of those are listed as best practices. So one more thing, and one piece it's part of that five core components, but it's not part of the structure, and we wanted it to be part of the structure. We've also found a way to make sure that the community has some oversight in what's going on, and that's important for us. We don't want to be an invasionary force into, you know, in a community. We want it to be part of the community. So when Larry Lee organized the Restoring the Village forums, he had a group of people that came forward and said they wanted to do something, and some of you were involved in that effort. And each of them was sort of assigned one of those areas, law enforcement or youth, the courts and so forth, and they became sort of a steering committee in and of themselves. That group is going to continue to serve as the community oversight group or advisory team for this model. So that one example is if we need to implement a prevention measure that's going to address children between the ages of 6 and 12, and access to firearms, for example, in our community. If we look on the OJJDP website, there are strategies that are best practices that have been implemented in other communities, and there's probably 3 or 4 for that particular risk factor. That'll go to this community advisory team, and we'll let them provide guidance on which one of those prevention measures should be implemented in our community. So, a little bit of an update on what we're doing. Okay, so that's an overview of the game model. Let me tell you where we're at. Okay, so there's the three sections of this. There's assessment, planning, the capacity building, and then the full implementation. Right now we're in the assessment phase. We've identified our key stakeholders. We formed a steering committee, which is the round table. We've established gang definitions, hired a project coordinator, and that's actually Officer Dreisenter, who's doing that on an interim basis, because why? We can't afford to hire a project coordinator, so we're just doing what we got to do to get it done for now, and she's doing a great job. Thank you, Danny. We're working on selecting a research partner, which is actually in a grant application that we have put in. And then we're doing comprehensive community assessment, which is actually a series of focus groups. That's one of the things that we're doing now, is trying to educate the community through you so that everybody knows what's going on. We're about 75% of the way done or better right now, right? Yes. Okay. Or better. Our idea is, our goal is to start implementing these measures following our community forum on September the 30th, which I'll tell you about in just a few seconds. So this assessment and planning phase, the comprehensive gang model talks specifically about communities that have made the mistake of just grabbing one of these strategies and implement it without doing this assessment. And I know you all are deeply involved in doing research, doing things based on science. That's the way we have to do business. So that they warn us against doing that. You've got to do, they said it's painful, it's slow, you're going to get chastised because it's taking too long and we need to do it right now, but this is the way you've got to do it if you want it to work. So we've got to determine the target area. We've got to define the primary target population, and these are the youth that are involved in the violent criminal activity. That's the primary target population. We've got to define the secondary target, youth at risk of committing gang crimes. I say this is the brothers and sisters of the youth that are committing the violent crime today, and the kids that are growing up in those neighborhoods, and then prioritize the problems. So those are objectives for the assessment planning phase. Most fortunately, most of that is already done right now. I want to take you through some of the data analysis. Some of this is just for demonstration purposes. Clint Sperber, Nancy Brown from the Parent Academy, and a whole group of individuals got together and poured through tons and tons and tons of data. And this is sort of just representative of the work that they did. They actually have a book that's 6 or 8 inches thick, full of data that we can look at to tell us what the problem is, as if we don't already know. One of the things I want to point out is this is the level of detail that they got. Compared to 2010, gunshot wound presentations to the Longwood Regional Medical Center have increased by 63% in 2013. And that shows the seriousness of the problem and the increase. And we've got tons of this data. Here's another group of data. We looked at all the violent crime in 2013 that occurred across St. Lucie County. So at the top of the map, where you see the dark red circle, is the Lincoln Park community in Fort Pierce, and then the bottom of the map is the city of Port St. Lucie. So that represents all the violent crime in St. Lucie County, and obviously the red map is where the most violent crime is concentrated. I've already told you where that's at. I'm sorry, was there a question?
That looks like our lightning weather map.
Yes, okay. Well, I wish it was lightning. Unfortunately, it's violent crime. So we took this map and we overlaid on top of it the residents of the gang members that we have in our database. And what's interesting to learn from this is that there's just as many gang members in Port St. Lucie as there are in Fort Pierce. This is a county-wide problem. That's what I want everybody to get out of this map. We arrest people in Fort Pierce for committing violent crimes that are from Port St. Lucie, and Port St. Lucie arrests people from Fort Pierce for committing violent crimes in Fort Pierce. Now, I do want to condition this before I upset my friends in Port St. Lucie. You'll see that there's a much higher concentration of gang membership in Fort Pierce if you just look at the difference in the population. And I can tell you this, that the types of crimes that the gang members are involved in are obviously different too. Okay, so we need to condition this on this. But I hope that this shows this is clearly a countywide problem, and I hope you can see the correlation between where the gang members live and the violent crime across our community. So from there, we zoomed in, because what we did was assess all of St. Lucie County. We're looking for the greatest amount of violent crime in the county. And obviously we find that that's in Fort Pierce, and specifically it's in the Lincoln Park community. So that's zoomed in there. So we zoom in a little bit more and we start breaking it down with the thresholds on the map. And we can see that it's not the whole Lincoln Park community. There's actually hotspots within the Lincoln Park community. So what you see is the dots on the map are gunshot incidents that we have, and then we see the red is from the other map. So we can start seeing pockets or hotspots that are occurring. So that's our target area. So the roundtable has adopted generally the Lincoln Park area, Orange Avenue to Avenue Q, and 33rd to 9th Street, I believe it is, on the east, as the target area that we're using. But we recognize the fact that there's hot spots within those areas, and that will get the initial attention from the comprehensive gang model. So just a couple little things. I'm not going to read all this to you. What the roundtable has done, the most important thing is they have identified violent crime as their number one strategic priority moving into the future. So the roundtable is redoing their comprehensive strategy right now. We've had a strategy that we've used for 15 years, been very successful. We're redoing that strategy now. The violent crime problem will be the number one priority in that strategy. They've adopted the comprehensive gang model as the model that's going to be used to address the violent crime, at least in respect to the youth crime. There's other types of violent crime in our community, like domestic violence, child abuse, that are just as serious, that need to be addressed. And then started expanding membership to include some members that better represent the Lincoln Park community. And then so far we've defined the target area, the organizational structure, gang definitions, and appointed an interim coordinator. So how are we going to pay for all this? We have applied for about $1.6 million in grant funding from Department of Justice, Department of Health, everybody that has a stake in this. We're probably not going to get $1.6 million. You don't get every grant that you applied for. But if we can get the $1 million grant or the $400,000 grant, we can implement this gang model at a very high level in our community. Let's say we don't get any of these grants, or we get the $20,000 grant, or we go to Children's Services Council and ask for help. The county has indicated that they may be able to help financially. We can implement this model. The question is, how large? How grand can we implement the model? We need to do it at the $1 million level. We can do it at the $40,000 or $80,000 level. So we're working with our partners to make sure that this gets implemented. I'm fairly confident in a couple of these grants. Fairly confident in a couple of these grants will help us kick this off. So we've actually started working on one of the things we recognized early on is we weren't probably doing the best job that we could in terms of communicating what's going on and what the plan is. So that's one of the reasons why we're here tonight. We've actually put together a communication and community engagement plan. So planned dissemination of information through mass media, radio, print, television. We're going to do a show on the school board's network TV to try to get the word out. We were having several focus group sessions, and those are ongoing now. This is actually one of the focus group sessions. We're hoping we get some feedback from you at some point in the future in terms of the plan, where we're actually talking with youth and the residents, educators, government elected officials, business leaders, and actually sitting down and interviewing some of the gang members themselves and getting their input on what should be done to stop this problem in our community. And lastly, if you don't take anything else away from this presentation, on September 30th at Lincoln Park Academy, 5:30 p.m., we're having a Restoring the Village Youth Initiative public forum, and what we're actually doing is having experts from the National Gang Center come in. They're going to do that forum for us. The idea is to educate the community on what the comprehensive gang model is, and hopefully we get the community's support to implement it. And like I said, we should be ready to start implementing it on October 1st. So that's it.
We'd like folks to join us at 6:30 at Lincoln Park Academy.
Is it 6:30?
Yes, sir.
Change the time. Thank you. I appreciate that. 6:30 at Lincoln Park Academy. Any questions?
Yes, Ms. Hensley?
You know, Chief, I don't have questions, but I will have comments. Some of us have been around for a very long time working on this. I don't want the community to think that we're going away from the things we're already working. This is another piece to help us focus. So things that the roundtable has been doing, or they will continue doing, the hand-in-hand has been very successful. That's going to progress. The programs Children's Services Council have been funding, they're very successful. Those are going to progress. What this does is help us target in on a very specific area. And we know that some of us were around years ago when we had multiple gang shootings at Sportsman Park and Port St. Lucie and at Cumberland Farms at Darwin Square and all those type of things. So it's generational, and we've never been able to approach probably that piece, that is that generational piece. And a lot of these kids are, like you said, it's got to include the families, because that's where a lot of this is coming from. Not all of it, but a lot of it. So I'm very pleased to see that we will be targeting a very specific hot spot, but have best practices so that if that hot spot moves around, we will not be in a position to be hamstrung, so we cannot take care of it countywide. And I have heard, and that's why I'm going to be very emphatic on that, nothing is going to change what's already in place. It's just going to add another layer, very focused layer, on what's going on with the gang issues. So we will all get behind this. We'll all be very supportive. And I don't think that it has a chance of being unsuccessful. Because if you look at the track record in this county, when we take on really hard things and really unpopular things, we have been very successful, especially when it focuses on the needs of children.
So if you don't mind, if I could just respond. I wasn't going to do this, but I'm going to. I'm going to speed forward here. I want to join you. And what if we look at crime, specifically in the city of Fort Pierce, but this applies countywide. And we go back to the middle 80s, where crime reached its peak. Over since 1987, when it reached its peak, we have cut crime in the city of Fort Pierce alone, let alone countywide, violent crime by more than 60%. And that is an incredible accomplishment. And it's not because of the gang model, because we weren't doing it. It's because all the things that we have done, the partnerships, and it's no coincidence that in 1987 is when the Roundtable of St. Lucie County first started meeting and putting together their comprehensive plan. And I truly believe, somebody asked, okay, so how have you been so successful? It's the collaboration and the partnership that we've gotten together with all of our partners and everybody coming together. And this is, like you said, it's really a way to just focus resources on the youth gang members that we really need to pay some attention to. So it's a continuation of what we have been doing for 15 years. You're exactly right.
Dr. Mills?
Chief Baldwin, when we talk about gang members, and I really appreciate this initiative and this work that we're about to set upon really focusing on gang members, I think about all of the programs that we do have out there that are preventive or intervention type programs all throughout the North Fort Pierce, the Lincoln Park area, and yet we still have that problem with that group that's not attending the programs that are out there. The ones that are attending, I'm sure we're making a difference in their lives. But I appreciate this focus on the group of kids and young people who are not attending any programs, who are not within our schools right now and within our sports or within certain areas, to help them navigate through life at that critical time. So with saying that, you mentioned that this strategy will have a coordinator and we'll have outreach workers. And I just wanted to ask you this question with the outreach workers and the coordinator. It's going to be important that we get the right people in the Lincoln Park area. When I say the right people, people that these young people can relate with. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely. That was one of the first lessons when we went to Dallas, is that you've got to have the right people in place. So the coordinator needs to manage the strategy, and especially with the street outreach workers. And in fact, when this whole notion of outreach workers for gangs started, it started in Boston. And they were actually hiring ex-gang members to go out and be the outreach workers and paying them a stipend. Now, over the years, they figured that maybe that doesn't work so well because of allegiances to different gangs and so forth. But definitely people from the community that already have built those relationships. That's the reason why the HIV outreach program was so successful, and that's the same reason why this will be so successful. But you're right, we got to have the right people in place that can go out and build a real relationship with these youth gang members. And just going back to it being very focused, we have done a phenomenal job. What we can learn from what we've done in the past is that we need to make a connection to these kids that are actually committing these violent crimes and pull them away from that.
Thank you.
Other questions? Thank you so much.
Thank you all for your support. And I want to publicly thank Superintendent Yost, who not only went to Dallas with it, but she's been in almost every meeting that we have had. She's stayed plugged in. And I think that's probably due to your leadership. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, Chief. We will be partners with the Youth Initiative. That will be our role throughout the school district. So thank you.
All right, we now move to our CTA report. And Ms. Tillman, welcome you to the podium.
Good turn for you. Chair Lady Holly, board members, and Superintendent Yost. Tonight I have Claire Cook, former president of St. Lucie CTA, and also secretary treasurer for the Florida Educational Association, joining me tonight. Tonight I've heard so much about purpose, reasons, collaborations, and it all sounds great. But tonight I want to talk about building level planning team, which we refer to it as BLPT. BLPT began under my tenure as CTA CU president. It was designed to have school-based decision making by all stakeholders. The union and the district received joint training from Stratix, a company with expertise and strategies for organizational and individual excellence, with the focus on building working relationships and developing trust. Having a common voice with the growing concern across the state in St. Lucie County, as we continue to have politicians dictate and put into law unfunded mandates that were determining our destiny, we in St. Lucie County took a bold step and decided to change the approach and culture of how we do business. Knowing that we would have challenges, we felt it was best for our school district. We had previously gone to impasse over issues and realized it had a negative connotation and impact on our educational community. The interest-based decision-making process was new. However, all parties came to the table guarded, but willing to work for what was best for our district. Did we struggle? Yes. Did we value that we develop and design something just for us in St. Lucie County? Yes. As we continued to learn, as we continued our learning, and the Stratics approach relied on a series of steps that helped us to achieve our visions and goals. It was obvious we all wanted to fix the problems and find a quick way to come to a quick solution without going through all the steps. As this training evolved, we did training with building level administrators and union reps throughout the district. Our desire was for schools to model what we had learned through our interest-based decision-making process. So we created the BLPT, Building Level Planning Teams. One of the greatest tidbits that we learned was ACBD, always check before doing. This was part of our breakdowns even on the district level, our failure to communicate appropriately. And that's what caused us to have lots of problems. The makeup of the teams at the each school site was the persons would be elected by their grade chairs or department team by their peers. Two people would be appointed by the principal and one by the union. The school principal is the chair of the committee. This gave a voice to those elected people and their peers at the school sites. This was not union, nor was it principal, nor district elections. This happened with their peers. Guidelines were created for all to follow and establish their norms at their particular school sites. When schools struggled with the process, we provided additional training. This was an all-inclusive, transparent process. Principals and teams were afforded the opportunity to come and observe how monthly meetings were done between the union and the school district. This is a learned process that would often need to be revisited. As the district team, we also had national trainers return to reteach and retrain the process to us, because we struggled as a district, because we needed to continue to build trust. Knowing the importance of our investment in our employees and creating an environment of collaboration was modeled on the district level. We went to individual schools and aided them and as we had to respond to them, and we provided intervention, as we should. We valued this opportunity to create leadership and a voice for the voiceless in a very democratic way. In addition, problems or concerns could be addressed through collaboration and in a school-based environment with their collective minds. Do you throw the baby out with the bathwater because someone feels it's just another meeting? I say no. Do you stop the process that opens the door for those in the trenches? I say no again. Do we silence the voices of those who don't agree with us? I say no. Do we embrace and accept the voices of those who process and think differently? I say yes. Now, I say to you as board members, do you allow the district to usurp your power as a board and decide to change the board, approve BLP choice days on the school calendar? Do you, as a board, allow the powers to be to usurp your elected constitutional officer's responsibility? These are personal. These are questions you have to answer for yourself. I ask you, are you willing to make the right decision and do what is lawful and right for the school district? Do you usurp your power as board members and allow board-approved job assignments to be changed for employees without your approval? And aside from all that, this becomes very personal to me because I have spent 35-plus years here in St. Lucie County as a firm, fair, and yet consistent teacher and union leader and president. I believe that anything that is presented the right way can be dissected and studied well enough, and we can get the right results through collective minds. Teachers, tactics used that are punitive must no longer continue in this district. If we are going to make a difference and be a model district across the state. Because when we first embarked upon interest-based decision-making process, we were one of the first and one of the most successful districts across the state. And for me, that had me with my own bragging rights. And I came to the podium and I shared that with you. We're gonna have to come back, go back, and look at what all of us have done. Be reflective about what each of us have done daily, good or bad, and ask yourself, what could I have done differently? We want no less than to have our ratified union contract to be adhered to and stay compliant with the law. We feel strongly that as all of you are constitutional officers of the law, of the school board, you all passionately serve the community. That includes the educational community. And in part of my research, I decided to go and look up the primary responsibilities of a school board member. And I copied and pasted like we all do. And the first thing says, set the vision and goals for the district. 2, adopt policies that give the district direction to set priorities and achieve its goal. Hire and evaluate the superintendent. Adopt and oversee the annual budget. Manage the collective bargaining process for employees of the district. I have given you all copies of our fact sheet. In addition to that, I have given you the first communication we started in 2003 with Stratex as a company and how we came to be where we are. I think oftentimes we forget the historical viewpoint. As I stated earlier, I do take it personal because as I've stated before, I take everybody as part of my family. And you know, when you have a family, we may not agree all the time, but guess what? That's still my family. I may not even like all the actions, but it's still my family. We are all in this St. Lucie County. We are part of a district. We have to do what's right. We have to make sure we're following the law. We have to make sure that you as board members don't usurp your authority as board members and do what is right. So now my former president and the president, I'm gonna say the Secretary of Treasury of Florida Education Association is going to just give you a brief word, few words as to how we have gotten to where we are.
Board members and Superintendent Yost, I find myself in a rather unique position tonight. Vanessa explained how we came about this collaborative bargaining process. Mrs. Hilson, Mrs. Hensley, you will remember because you joined with us in the training and it was quite extensive. But we all agreed that this is what we were committed to. Shortly after the training, as Vanessa said, I was elected as the Secretary Treasurer of the Florida Education Association. We represent every county in this state. And in that position, I have a wonderful opportunity to observe other districts, to see what they're doing, to see where their successes are. And there are other districts who are working collaboratively, but none of them have had the level of success that St. Lucie County has had over the last 10 years. That's why I'm shocked that you have chosen to violate a negotiated, ratified contract. It's unfortunate that we find ourselves here today airing our differences rather than working on them together, but I don't think it's too late. Even though both sides have attorneys, you can resolve this. To use a sports metaphor, the ball is in your court as a school board in St. Lucie County. You can do the right thing. You can rescind the letter that was sent to Mrs. Rodriguez and allow her to continue in her elected position. And her members expect that she will continue in that position without harassment. You can restore the building level planning teams, and you can do it now. Both the union, the board, and administration, we have so many other battles to fight together. We have so many battles to save public education in the state of Florida and to work for the students in St. Lucie County. Just as the police officer before us talked about, he said the word collaboration so many times and he talked about the successes. I'm saying to you, we've had successes here. Let's stop this foolishness and do the right thing. Thank you.
I would like to welcome Rick Paulette for the CWA report. Welcome to the podium, Mr. Paulette.
Good evening, board members, Ms. Yost, and everyone here. I'm Rick Paulette. I'm the president of Communication Workers of America. We represent, of course, the transportation workers, bus drivers, and mechanics, and food service, and so on. Everything that was just said prior to me coming up here is absolutely correct. We've had some serious, real successes in the collaborative process in St. Lucie County. Those of you who were around at the beginning when we first started the collaboration and the interest-based here know that the first thing that I did, the first thing that came out of me in the training was this and not this. Because I wasn't sure it was going to be good enough or it was going to even work. I had a lot of doubts about the collaborative process. And unfortunately, it seems to be coming true at this point. But prior to this point, it's been quite successful, a lot more successful for everyone, the school district and the employees, than I expected. I really didn't expect the success that we have and that we have created here, and the trust and that we had for each other and with each other in this process. But I got to tell you, I think like they said, I don't think it's too late to make this work. I think we've had some serious fallbacks. We've had some serious issues. You got new people coming on board, including new attorneys that unfortunately don't know what hell they're talking about. But nevertheless, but I will say, we're having issues too in CWA. I mean, there's this now there's interpretation of our contract as well. We can no longer file grievances on terminated employees. For the first time in the entire 12 years I've been here, we have not been able to file a grievance for a terminated employee. But we have all this time up until now. If there's an issue with or a problem out there with the way things are going or the way things have been going, that's why we have the bargaining table. We sit down and deal with it. In the collaborative process, we sit down and deal with it there before we hang somebody. That's what we do, and we haven't done that. Uh, And I just think that we can get back together. If we get back together and I think we can make this work, instead of fighting, which is, I mean, we can do it. We've been fighting. I fight everywhere else. We have Palm Beach County. We represent county workers. And we fight if we have to fight. But when we have cooperation, and you have cooperation, quite frankly, we get a lot more, a lot more stuff done, and we will in St. Lucie County. But if it's a matter now of attack, instead of let's sit down and collaboratively resolve these issues, the attack is going to go bad. We all know that. We've been there before. We don't want it to go bad. I think there's a lot of hope here, and I think that there has been hope. And I am sad as well, because I really was hoping this thing would work. And seeing what's going on right now doesn't look like it at this point. And I wish, maybe it's because some people need to go through the training as well that haven't been through it, things of that nature. I would suggest this, that you had a previous school board person who was here before us, Mike, you know him. He the one that started the collaborative thing for you. He was right on target. He tried to do the right thing. The way he did it, he got everybody involved. Everybody. And everybody from the top to the bottom had to say, yes, we're in this together. If everybody is not in it together, it can't succeed. It can't. And it's not succeeding. We see that. Okay? So I think there needs to be a recommitment on the board's part, from your level down, saying we want this and we want this to work and we want to have a collaborative, interest-based relationship together and try to work through these issues and problems without a knockdown dragout. We don't need it. We don't want a knockdown dragout. Hopefully you guys don't, because we can certainly do it if we have to, but we don't want to. We want to resolve this thing any way possible. So I ask you again to step up and do the right thing, and let's get everybody to the training. Let's make sure they're all trained the proper way. We're all trained the way we should be. We got new people we need to have trained. We talked about doing another training session, but nothing's come about it. And it almost sounds to me like the district has made a decision to get away from interest-based or get away from collaborative. For what reasons, I'm not sure. But I would ask you to reconsider that, if at all possible, because I do believe it works for everybody. And we've had a peaceful relationship over the last 10, 12, ever since we started this thing, for sure. More peaceful than not, we've been able to resolve issues out there through the collaborative process. And I really hope, quite frankly, pray that you all think about this. If you don't think about it now, think about it when you go home tonight, before you go to bed. When you say your prayer, talk to him about it. He might be able to help you with it. Okay? Thank you very much.
Board members, we will move to the consent agenda. I would entertain a motion at this time to accept the agenda as presented. Moved by Mr. Ingersoll, second by Ms. Hensley. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. At this time, board members, are there any conflicts that you need to declare before we move to the voting portion? Hearing none, we will receive the recommendation, Madam Superintendent.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend the board approve a total of 30 consent agenda items, beginning with 8.1 and ending with 15.1 as presented.
Board members, are there any amongst there that you would like to have comment on? Any that you wish to pull for separate vote and discussion? Hearing none, we have received the recommendation for approval of the consent agenda items. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Dr. Mills. Do I hear
second
by Ms. Hilson? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. We move now to the other business, the stipulated findings of fact. Madam Superintendent.
I recommend the board approve stipulated findings of fact, conclusions of law and penalty, and final orders number 426 through 439 as presented.
Thank you, board members. We have the recommendation. Do I hear a motion?
Second.
By Ms. Hensley, second by Mr. Ingersoll. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries 5-0. And at this point then, we will move to the superintendent's report. Madam Superintendent?
Yes, ma'am. As I do each meeting, I'd like to begin with some kudos to our employees, beginning with Carly Fabricant, who has made the top 12 list of finalists as indicated in the Tribune. She is a healthcare champion, and on October 2nd, we will find out whether or not she is identified as the finalist, the winner of the overall initiative. We know that her efforts in the area of health have made and wellness have made a difference for us, and we congratulate her. Moving on to an instructional partner, a teacher on special assignment within the Title I school renewal area is Leslie Taylor, who has been identified as the Florida Outstanding Biology Teacher of the Year for the state, and we congratulate Leslie on that accomplishment. Kudos to her. And the week ahead will bring National Arts and Education Week, and there are many outstanding programs in the area of art, drama, dance that will be recognized. We will feature or highlight a program each day as we tweet out and send information, focusing on specific programs, our instructional staff, as well as our student involvement during that time. Also want to remind board members that there is an executive session immediately following tonight's board meeting. In closing, I want to focus upon the comments of our CTACU leadership. And I, too, was a part of the groundbreaking efforts that we are so proud of with Stratix. Collaborative bargaining was something totally unique in St. Lucie County in the state of Florida. And there were many bragging rights amongst many individuals over time. It is unfortunate that we are at the point we are at right now. Recent messages and news releases from the CTACU led us to believe that they are surprised that actions taken by me, the deputy superintendent, and the legal staff were surprising. Conversations regarding the need to revamp our building level planning teams began informally, really in the spring, and union representatives, as they have stated, although collaborative in conversation, seem complacent in their need to progress until a steering committee meeting of August 21st, where Ms. Rodriguez indicated that the union's position regarding contract language relative to Article 15D5 was to remain status quo as the entire contract expired on June 30th, 2014. The district's position did not align with that of the union, and Dr. Rendell, who was present at the steering committee meeting, stated that during that particular meeting, at which time Ms. Rodriguez issued a demand that our district direct principals to hold BLPT elections and calendar meetings by the end of August, or the CTA would file an unfair labor practice claim. Although we agree that the majority of the expired CTA contract does remain status quo until a new contract is approved by the school board and ratified by the CTA, we believe we must look at the contract language to determine what is status quo. That's our primary difference. We believe that Articles 11, Paragraph O, and Article 11, D5 contain contract language outside of the status quo. In fact, I understand during the steering committee of the 21st of August, CWA President Rick Poulette even pointed out that some sections may fall under a different section and not remain status quo, if there is a separate language and a trigger event. That is the position of the district, and it remains our current position. The two sections possess identical contract language. The identically crafted language in the sections are only two sections in question today. This is not about retaliation or an inability to hear the voice of our staff. In fact, the voice of our staff has enabled us to aggressively listen to your needs that led to increased wages, the ability to fund steps, focus groups that yielded concerns for time and planning, planning time that was restored at the middle school level. Budgetary barriers prevented us from moving forward at the high school level this year. However, it has not been forgotten. When Ms. Tillman was asked to discuss the two articles, she indicated that the attorneys would talk. She was advised not to discuss this matter with me. I respect that opinion. That decision then forces Ms. Rodriguez's return to the classroom while our attorneys discuss contract language. At this time, Ms. Rodriguez has not reported to her newly assigned position. We have received feedback from her attorney stating that she will not report to the assigned position since the school board has not authorized the transfer. According to the contract, when Ms. Rodriguez's leave of absence expired and she was to be assigned to a position with her in her area of certification, that has occurred. Section 1012.22(1)(e) of the Florida Statute 2013 does not apply. The district will continue to comply with state statutes and school board policy as applicable. On September 4th, Ms. Tillman did read into the minutes of another steering committee meeting that they would move back to collective bargaining effective 90 days from the receipt of the letter. And today, Dr. Rendell received two grievances from Ms. Rodriguez regarding these two matters. Perhaps the grievances, I hope these grievances, will enable us to converse regarding the two contract articles of concern. I will offer again an opportunity to discuss the matter with CTACU leadership. Collective bargaining did have many advantages. Collaborative bargaining did have many advantages in St. Lucie County. I will restate again an opportunity to discuss this matter with the CTACU leadership. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Superintendent. Mr. Harold, any report tonight from the attorney? Okay. We move to our school board member reports. And before we have our individual reports, board members, as you'll recall, with the contract with our superintendent, we are charged with her evaluation as she is an appointed superintendent. Remind you that each of us had an opportunity during the month of August, as the contract required, to have individual conversations with Mrs. Yost regarding the past year and the upcoming year. Also, by contract, as near to September 1 as possible in a public meeting, we are to have a vote as to whether her performance is satisfactory or unsatisfactory. This is our opportunity if you wish to speak to the conversation, or I will entertain a motion at this time.
I'll give a motion to give the superintendent a performance that is overall satisfactory.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on the floor for an overall satisfactory performance. Ms. Hensley was the second. Mr. Ingersoll made the motion. Okay, board members, we have the motion and the second. Do I hear all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. And we can now move to the individual reports. And Ms. Hensley, we'll begin with you tonight.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You'll get to hear some of the same things you've heard a few times. One is the Children's Services Council's campaign for reauthorization kickoff is the 18th at Scott Van Duzer's Big Apple Pizza, 4:30 to 7 o'clock. I will make sure that you get some information sent to you directly. It's an opportunity, as you know, to show support for that great effort. And as you also know, there is no way to pick up the slack if it is not reauthorized. So the county commission has said they do not have the funds to be able to fill that hole. So it is extremely important, and it has made significant progress in our county over the years. Also, the Indian River Lagoon Science Festival is coming up on the 27th. I would like to invite everybody to participate. It's free. It is focused on all the big pictures of science, not just the lagoon, and it is, of course, focused on children and science. So that ought to be a lot of fun. We expect to have between 50 and 80 vendors and food trucks and that sort of thing, and it's a very nice location. So that's going to be pretty exciting. And I also remember that our superintendent suggested that in the near future we're going to say, what are you reading Tuesdays? And just so you know, I'm rereading To Kill a Mockingbird, and I am reading The Future by Al Gore. So it's light reading.
Thank you, Ms. Hensley. Ms. Hilson? No report. Dr. Mills?
I just want to reiterate something that I heard our superintendent say. She's stretching a hand out for collaborative process with our union reps. And so I think that's important to hear, that the hand is out there. And regarding our, we can do what we need to do to continue on a collaborative basis, I'm sure. And so there's no need to fight, as I heard one say. I'm hearing that the hand is still stretched out there, so hopefully that is what you've heard, and we can move forward from here. And I have no further comments this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Mills. Mr. Ingersoll?
Yes, ma'am. I just wanted to congratulate you and Dr. Mills on winning your elections. Congratulations. Also, we have a couple of activities coming up. Bowl for Kids' Sakes, which I know a lot of schools participate in, and I want to thank you in advance for your participation for the Boys and Girls Club. And also, the same night is Dancing with Pals. So if anyone needs tickets, I have them.
And I have it on very good authority that Mr. Ingersoll is one of the contestants.
Yes, I will be dancing. That's what they tell me. I don't know. I could dance either. I have a great dance partner.
It might be worth the price of the ticket.
It'll be a good laugh. No. And also, this issue between the district and the union, and it breaks my heart that it's come to this. And board members, this has lasting impacts, too. As you know, we'll be in a superintendent search here, and that's one of the last things that we want to have on our head is the relationships have been strained between us, especially when they've been mended after the last few budget years, and that is definitely a concern. When I talked to Vicki and Vanessa, I was also trained, not when you guys were trained, I was brought on, and Mike made sure that I was attending training just to understand the process. And what happens, I've noticed in St. Lucie County, is we do well training, and then we stop the process, and we just think people assume it. We have a lot of new leadership at the district office and everywhere else, and we do have to get back to that. I'm a firm believer in it. And I also, looking at the timeline too, is we got 8 months, so we have to be careful in what we do and what we say, because we are a family. We all need to take care of one another. And I hope that the district and the union can work this out for the benefit of just not our image, but also for the children that are invested in our community and that they look up to you. We don't need the distractions. So between the two of you, hopefully we hope something can work out.
Thank you, Mr. Ingersoll. Board members, I have a couple of housekeeping issues to remind you of. 2 weeks from today, our annual board retreat is scheduled from 9 to 2 at the Kaiser University. Ms. Harrison has put menus in each of your boxes, so if you would please get the your food choice to her as long as well as the money to her. We will have that ready for that board retreat. And there will not be a work session that day, and that it will all be incorporated into the board retreat. The District Advisory Council began their meetings last night for the school year, and I want to thank those of you that attended and the principals for ensuring that you had representatives there. We had a good turnout, look forward to a very good year ahead, and hope that you will make opportunities during your school advisory council meetings for your district advisory council person to make a report from that, as we have a lot of good information that is shared there. So please make sure to have that as an agenda item on your school advisory councils. And I have recently been appointed to the Center for AgriLife Research and Entrepreneurship Advisory Board. Its acronym is CARE2, and they are attempting to get $1 million in funding from the Economic Development Administration for the United States. And what that would do is enable food crops to be grown locally and sold locally, utilized locally on a much grander scale. So they have asked for a letter of support from our board saying that we are supportive of this Sunshine Kitchen Food Business Incubator project, and I would like your permission to proceed with that letter of support.
You want a motion?
Please.
I'll make a motion to go ahead with what you just said.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Ingersoll, and second by Dr. Mills. All in favor?
Aye.
A motion carries 5-0, and I will get that off to them. All of the other government leaders are providing the same type letter in support of that as we move forward. So thank you for that. And to again address the issue before us, and to say that you have the promise of the board to look at all of these intricacies and to move forward in a way that absolutely benefits our students, because we all know that our students are why we get up every morning and why we do what we do. So you have our assurance to work, as Ms. Yost has said, and extending the hand. We do want to have conversation and look forward to that. At this point, we will go to our unscheduled speakers, and we do have several tonight. So before we begin that, I would like just to say a few words about it to remind everyone of how the procedure works, and also to remind our fellow board members that this is our opportunity to listen to you all. So we will sit here with two ears and not utilize our mouth. We want to hear what you have to say. And I would ask that as I call the ones forward, that you would be respectful of their time at the podium, because it is a 3-minute limit, as our policy dictates, and Mr. Harrell will help ensure that we adhere to that. But if you would just, as we will, be respectful of your peers as they speak. Sometimes it's difficult to hear up here because we're behind the microphones, and if there's a lot of noise from the audience, we can't really hear what the speaker is saying, and we do genuinely want to hear what you all have to say. So I'm going to call individuals forth, and I'm going to call them in the order that we received the forms, if that's